Hello children, we'll be taking lesson 10, the Mauryan Empire. In the first part of the video, some part of the chapter, I had explained. Now in the second part, we'll be starting from the Mauryan administration. The Mauryan introduced a very efficient administrative system, and this was divided into four heads: central, provincial, district and village. Now the central administration, it was headed by the king and was held by the Mantri Parishad, which means council of ministers, and these officials were known as Amatyas. Now the provincial administration was headed by prince, and district were administered by Pradeshikas. Pradeshikas means the head of the district, and he was held by the officials like Yuktas and Rajukas. Rajukas means the officer in charge of the land measurement, and Yuktas means the subordinate officers for king's revenue. Now the district had many nagaras or towns, and the gramas or villages which were administered by the other officials. Now the capital city was Pataliputra, which was governed separately. It had three member committee.
Start.
Now this capital city was governed separately, and it had 30 members committee, which was divided into 6 boards, and each board took care of certain departments, which included trade, industry, commerce, tax collection, care of travelers, registration of births and deaths. Now, the Mauryan had a very powerful army, which was headed by Senapati. Senapati means the commander-in-chief of the army. And the Mauryan included chariots, elephants, infantry, cavalry and navy. Now, what is infantry? Infantry means the soldiers who fought on foot. And cavalry means the soldiers who fought on horses. And there was department for making quality checking and maintenance of weapons also. Now another important feature was an effective spy system was set up by the king and the officials if any wrongdoings. Now spy system is secret system. Okay, they secretly reported to the king if anyone was doing any wrong. Okay. And the administration gained money mainly from the land revenue collections, gifts, fines, crafts, trade, custom duties, wines and forest. Now next we'll come to the Mauryan society and economy. Now Mauryans had a very flourishing economy. Flourishing economy means the economy was very strong. There was a lot of money in the market. And the people were mostly engaged as farmers, artisans, cattle herders and carpenters. You know what are farmers? Artisans means the people who made things. Okay. And cattle herders means those who took cattle for grazing and all. And carpenters, those who made things out of wood. Now many were engaged as traders also. What do you mean by traders? Traders means buying and selling things in the market. That is called trading in a large scale. Okay. Now Takshila, Ujjain, Pataliputra, Broch were the important trading center. Important trading center means this were the places from which mainly the buying and selling and every market activity was done. They carried goods to Sri Lanka, China, Egypt and Rome.
Three.
Next children will come to the Mauryan art. Okay. Now this Mauryan art was very vast and very nice also. The caste was not very important, and the people of different castes lived together in peace. And many monasteries and stupas were built during the Mauryan period. Now, what is monasteries? Monasteries are the vihara. Monasteries were the places where the monks lived and prayed. Okay. And stupas were the dome-shaped building where relics of Buddha and his monks were kept. Relics of Buddha means the remains of the things what Buddha used were kept. Now, monolithic pillar inscribed with the edicts of Ashoka are the remarkable example of Mauryan art. What do you mean by monolithic pillar? Monolithic pillar means the pillars or the statues and all which were built from one piece of rock only. And pillar architecture was very famous. And what do you mean by inscribed? Inscribed means what was written on the pillar. Okay, edicts of Ashoka. Do you remember the edicts of Ashoka we had taken in the previous video? The teachings of Ashoka. Okay. And one example of the pillar is at Sarnath near Varanasi, that is lion capital. You can see in the picture, the first one, you can see three lions are visible. but actually it is having four lions sitting back to back. This shows the, this resembles the four directions. Okay. And this has been adopted as the Indian emblem also. This pillar has four lions sitting back to back. So they look in four direction. And each lion has a chakra below it. You can see that there is a chakra below each lion. And this has been adopted as our, or taken as our this emblem also. And this emblem can be seen in our national flag too. Okay. Yes. Second picture, can you see? That is Sanchi Stupa, which is near Bhopal. Can you see the dome shaped figure and the pillars where something is inscribed on that? This is Sanchi Stupa. Okay, which is near Bhopal. Next, we come to the decline of Mauryan Empire. Now, what do you understand by the word decline? Decline means the fall. Okay, when, how did it come to the end? Now, here the Mauryan Empire was too vast. That means it was too big. And Ashoka's descendants could not control it. Ashoka's descendants means the generation which came after Ashoka. They were not very powerful, not very strong. And they could not control this vast and big empire. And moreover, the Ashoka's non-violent policies. What do you mean by non-violent policies? Non-violence means not to fight. Okay. This policy had weakened the army also, which was unable to defend the empire. The third point here is the finances. Finances mean the money matters. Okay. The finances were not good and there was not enough money to pay the large number of officials. Finally, Pushyamitra Sunga, who was the founder of the Sunga dynasty, he defeated King Brihadatta. Who was King Brihadatta? The last Mauryan ruler. In which year? In 185 BCE, and took over the power. In this way, the end of the Mauryan Empire came.